Launching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good morning and welcome back to Community Health. It is Health Education 395. Just disregard that picture back there. There we go. Now we've got the right class. Welcome. This week is our seventh broadcast for the semester, which means we've reached our halfway mark. And I am happy to have you with us. Today we are going to be continuing our discussion about nutrition and physical activity and how those issues impact our community and what we might be able to do in our communities to the betterment of all of our health. And so certainly I do want to let you know that I appreciate your participation in this broadcast, so you can give me a call on the 800 number. You can email me at the show's email address, because we certainly would like to entertain some discussion around our topics that really relate to what can we do to not only increase the health of an individual, but really make an impact on our community. So let's just take a step back and think about where we've been. Last week we spent a lot of time talking about the cost of unhealthy eating, factors that influence healthy eating, the nutrients, the dietary guidelines for Americans. We talked about My Plate. So after all of that discussion, did you think maybe a little bit more about your own nutrition? Did you think about what you were eating, what you were doing, what you were choosing? Did you have an opportunity to share some of that with those in your community? And remember, we define our community very individually. Your community can be your friends, it can be your family, it can be your neighborhood, it can be the little town that you live in. We all define our community differently, and there are times that we have to change that definition. But anyway, so what I hope that you were able to think about some of this, not only for yourself, but you were able to share it with others and hopefully impact their health in a positive way. And in individuals doing that, you know, certainly create the momentum for community change. So today we're going to look very quickly at just a couple of food issues and a little bit of physical activity, but I am very excited to share with you that we'll have a guest in the studio today that is an excellent example of an individual assessing community need, looking at what needs to be done, coming up with an idea, working with a multitude of audiences, is actually getting some stuff done to improve the health of many communities across LA. So let's just do a very quick flyby review. Remember, because this is going to be important as we have our guest here today and try to understand what he did in the framework of what we're all learning. Remember that when it comes to changing eating behaviors, when it comes to promoting health in a community around nutrition, we need to remember, first off, that we need to promote the access to healthy foods. We need to address the stigma of using food assistance programs, whether that's CalFresh, food banks, farmers markets, etc. We really are looking at that particular item, promoting access, we have to look through it the lens of our attitudes, the social norms around those, and building the confidence to act, to engage, to access those healthy foods in through those venues. The second thing we talked about was increasing knowledge about choosing healthy foods. Not only do we need to provide access, but we actually need to increase the knowledge around what to choose. And certainly that came out last week as we talked about the dietary guidelines, as we talked about My Plate, really looking at what the dietary guidelines have to say. We're looking at balancing calories, so making sure that when we're consuming calories, we're actually expending them as well. We were looking at foods to increase, fruits and vegetables, low-fat or non-fat dairy, lean proteins, making half of our grains whole grains. Those are all the things that we want to increase our consumption. The foods where we want to decrease and are identified in the dietary guidelines are those that have a lot of sodium, saturated fat, refined grains, sugars, and alcohol. We really want to take a step back from some of the foods that we may have been consuming, or our communities are consuming a lot of, and replace those with those foods to increase. So taking out some of the high fat, high salt, high sugar foods and replacing them with lots of fruits and vegetables and less fat through dairy and meat and more whole grains. Obviously, we know that we don't necessarily eat by food group, but the My Plate image gives us a frame of reference for what it looks like when we actually sit down to eat. You know, in the past, I reminded you we'd had pyramids. We don't eat by a pyramid. We eat by a plate. So really looking half that plate, fruits and vegetables, a big section of the plate being at least half of it whole grain, and then a smaller portion being the protein. And then, of course, over to the side, we have some dairy. Okay, so we're going to promote access to healthy foods. We're going to increase knowledge about choosing healthy foods. And the last is developing the competence in the health skills. Remember, we need to be able to access valid health information. That's reading food labels. Analyzing our influences. Why do we choose this food over that food? Or this meal over that one? We need to help our students and our families and our community members understand about the process of making a decision and encourage them to make healthier decisions, setting healthier goals, and then actually just practicing healthy behaviors. Getting in there and actually eating healthier foods is really where we want to get them to. So we know that through all of this, as a health educator, we need to look at our attitudes about all of these issues. Sometimes we need to leave our attitudes at the door. We need to know our audience. Who is it that we are trying to do this health promotion with? What is it about them? Their culture, their age, their gender, their experiences, their language, their literacy level. I mean, there's a variety of issues to consider when we consider changing someone, a community's behavior. We really have to know that community and to understand what will work and what won't work. And then there are times that we need some print materials. So how do we address our communities and meeting their needs with the print materials that are available to us? So we also want to make sure that we address some of the food issues in the community. And I just want to highlight these very quickly for you. The first is sugar-sweetened beverages. We are consuming gallons of sugar-sweetened beverages through a variety of drinks. We used to talk about sodas, but now I talk about energy drinks. I talk about vitamin waters. I talk about the coffees and the teas that we drink. So let's take a real quick look at a video clip called Rethink Your Drink.
The average person eats almost 100 pounds of sugar a year. All of the sugar leads to extra calories, which leads to extra weight. It's no wonder the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention say that 2 out of every 3 Americans are overweight or obese. Obesity puts you and your children at risk for diabetes, heart disease, cancer, hypertension, dyslipidemia, stroke, osteoarthritis, liver, and gallbladder disease. The single biggest source of the sugar is from sugary drinks. How much sugar is in these drinks? 4 grams of sugar equals 1 teaspoon. The average 20-ounce bottle of soda has about 29 grams of sugar per serving, or just over 7 teaspoons of sugar. These sodas usually offer more than 2 servings per bottle. So if you drink this whole bottle, you're really getting 73 grams of sugar. Divide that by 4, and you'll see that you are actually eating a little over 18 teaspoons of sugar. Instead of all this sugar, what does your body really need? Water. Water is all your body needs for hydration and for it to work properly. A healthy way of flavoring your water is by adding slices of fruit like melon, strawberries, lemon, lime, and even cucumber. So rethink your drink and pick water.
Okay, so I hope you'll rethink your drink, and I hope you will promote water consumption to your audience, to your community. All right, so that's one issue that we have to deal with when we are considering these dietary guidelines for Americans, is just what are we actually doing in our communities. The other issue that we should think about and address are fast foods. We have all become very fast-paced, and we now have an increased reliance upon fast food. In the 70s, maybe 20% of families frequented a fast food restaurant over the period of a week. In the 90s, it was up to over 30, and I haven't seen the latest figures, but my guesstimate is that it is much higher now. These foods are typically high in fat, salt, and sugar. They are larger portions, they are eaten quickly, and they are expensive, even though they are convenient. So we certainly look at our food environment when we are considering promoting the health of a community. You know, does our neighborhood have an overabundance of fast food restaurants? Where are there opportunities for us to put in healthier food choices? The other issue that I want to just bring to your awareness is the whole idea of the serving size. Our portions have been distorted over time. We used to eat small bagels, small muffins, small cookies, small bags of popcorn, small hamburgers. You get my drift? Now everything is larger. And we can even add to it by adding, you know, upgrading to the next size for just a few pennies more. So we really have distorted our portions. And I think because we are eating out so much, we see the portions served there, and then we're actually bringing it home. And even when we're at home, we may be eating too big of a portion. The other issue is, in this overabundance of food and little physical activity, we know that many of us are gaining weight, and we are all looking for a quick fix. And that's what I'm talking about, are fad diets. Fad diets typically come and go. There's a fad diet of the day or of the month or of the year. But what we have seen about all of them is there is no quick fix. It takes a while for us to add on this weight. It will take a while, and it will take work to get it off. We can't take a pill for it. We can't focus on one particular food. Many years ago, it was a grapefruit diet. We ate grapefruit until, you know, we had sores in our mouths. And that was supposed to help us lose weight. Well, what we were doing is we were depriving our body of other nutrients. In the past, we've had extremely low-calorie diets. We've had low-fat diets. We've had low-carb diets. We've had high-protein diets. All of those have a significant negative impact on the functioning of our bodies. Our bodies were meant to deal with all of these foods in balance and of sufficient quantity to meet the needs of all the internal functioning that goes on. And the reason I want to stress this is something we get into hearing advertisements, and we believe what those advertisements are saying. We believe what our friend is saying when he says, you know, I just drink this in my water every day, and look, I've been able to bulk up my muscles. I perform better. I can lift more weight. Whatever. Really, we have to let go of that. We have to really look at labels. We have to read the research behind it. We have to be able to look beyond what we've heard and look for the precautions around it. And I think that's really important when you're working and looking at a community. Is sometimes we can look at something that's very tangible, i.e. the excess number of fast food restaurants and the lack of fresh produce in the mom and pop stores, or a grocery store that's a walkable distance in the neighborhood. And we tend to forget some of the things that are a little bit more hidden. And so that's why I bring out the fad diets there as well. Okay, so certainly all of those issues can pop up in any community, and we need to be able to rely on what we have learned about the dietary guidelines and what we know about health behaviors and getting folks to think about changing to get us to that point. One of those health skills that we so desperately want individuals to understand is reading food labels and really looking at that as a accessing valid health information so that they can make some healthier decisions and engage in some healthier behaviors. So let's take a look at this video clip on reading food labels. And afterwards, I will introduce our guest to you, and we can talk about what he's doing to address some of the issues we've just highlighted. So if we could have the video.
Nutrition facts labels are key to helping us know which foods to choose and how much of them to eat or drink. Now, they can be a little confusing, so we're going to look at one and discuss what all the words mean and the numbers mean and how you can use them to make healthier selections. And the very, very first thing you should always look at is the serving size. This is really important. If you change the serving of the amount of food or drink, then you have to change all the other numbers on the label. This label has 1 cup or 228 grams as the serving size. You would need to measure out 1 cup using a measuring cup or weigh out 228 grams using a food scale. That means if you ate the entire container, you would be eating 2 times the amount listed below. That's why you always need to check the label and use measuring cups, like these. Measuring cups are wonderful and can really help with portion control. So let's head home and talk about calories. Calories are the energy in our food, and we have to have a balance of the calories that we eat and the calories that we burn, like through exercise. So if we eat more calories than we burn, we gain weight. But if we burn more calories than we eat, then we lose weight. Calories come from fat, carbohydrates, and protein. The next item on the label is total fat. Let's take a look at the breakdown of the different types of fat. Saturated fat and trans fats are the bad fats. They can raise LDL or bad cholesterol in the body, which increases the risk for heart disease. Sometimes you see polyunsaturated and monounsaturated fat listed on the label. These are the good fats. They help maintain your HDL or your good cholesterol in your body. Even though these fats are heart healthy, you still want to limit the portion because they're high calorie. Total carbohydrates. Underneath the total carbs on the label, it gives you a breakdown of different types of carbs. Dietary fiber is healthy and something we should get plenty of. Sugar is another type of carb and it should be eaten in moderation. Protein is a nutrient that helps build our muscles, our skin, and our hair. Below the black line, you will find some of, but not always all of, the vitamins and minerals in that product. Along the right side of the nutrition facts label, you will see a list of percentages for each nutrient, which shows the percent daily value. The percent daily value is for someone following a 2,000 calorie diet. What it's saying is, if you were to eat one cup of this product, you would be getting 18% of your total fat needs for the day. But what if you're not on a 2,000 calorie diet? Here's a quick guide for you. If the percentage is 5% or less, it means it's low. But if it's 20% or more, it means it's high. And if it's between 5% and 20%, then it means it's in the middle. The nutrients that are good to be low are in this section here. Total fat, saturated fat, trans fat, cholesterol, and sodium. The nutrients you want to be high are fiber and vitamins and minerals. Now that we've learned to read a nutrition facts label, let's use our knowledge to compare products. Here we have 2% milk, which is reduced fat milk, and fat-free milk, which is skim milk. If we look at the labels, both serving sizes are the same, one cup. However, the 2% milk is 130 calories per serving, and the fat-free milk is 90 calories per serving. So, by choosing the fat-free milk, we'll be saving 40 calories per serving. Let's compare the fat and cholesterol. The 2% milk's daily value is 8% for the total fat, 15% for the saturated fat, and 7% for the cholesterol. Check out the fat-free milk. The percent daily value is 0% for the total fat, saturated fat, and cholesterol. Now this is interesting. All the other nutrients are very similar in each of the milks. You get all the good nutrients in the fat-free milk without the calories, bad fat, and cholesterol. So now that you know how to read a nutrition facts label, you have all the tools you need for picking out healthy foods and healthy portions.
All right, well, welcome back. Let me make sure I'm on the right camera. I hope you learned a little bit more about reading food labels. I do need to interject that the FDA just released some information this week that there are some proposals for changing food labels to actually make them easier for all of us to read. So I think that will be a good thing, but I'm not sure how soon that will all take place. So please, keep your eyes on the labels. And, part of this whole class is keeping your eyes on what's happening in your community. And I'd like to introduce my guest today. This is Tomas O'Grady.
Thank you for having me.
Tomas is representing Enrich LA. And I'm going to just ask you to tell us a little bit about yourself. And then, sure. What is this organization, Enrich LA?
Well, it's actually very simple. I am from the west of Ireland. I grew up on a farm in the west of Ireland. And whilst Ireland is not known for its wonderful cuisine, we certainly had Whole Foods at least. And I'm from a family of eight, and we used to sit around every evening. We had dinner. We took our time. I was just talking to your producer outside earlier. It was about, we just took our time. We had a meal. Mm-hmm. And in the city of Los Angeles, I think that's missing. People are on the run. You were talking about that earlier. Fast food is a problem. And so we are trying to get school gardens into public schools, particularly in the south part of the city, and get kids in particular, and then their parents, to appreciate good whole foods and actually hopefully turn them into food snobs. That's what we want to happen.
I love it. Well, as I understand, Enrich LA is an environmental nonprofit organization, but you have this phenomenal partnership with schools.
Yes.
And in the building and the care of all of these gardens, you've just brought in collaboration
yes.
from multiple arenas. What I'd like to do is just to show a video clip about Enrich LA. And I think that'll give us a little bit more background, and it's got some great visuals of what actually happens with this organization. So can we see that clip?
My name is Tomas Grady, and I am the executive director of Enrich LA. So we are basically a school garden nonprofit. We put edible gardens in public schools. And we're here today at Bryson Elementary, which is in the city of Southgate, just south of Los Angeles. Enrich LA, we started about 14 months ago. I actually put a garden in at my daughter's school, at Thomas Star King Middle School in Las Feliz. And then I saw what a positive effect it had on the school. And my friend Leonardo and I decided, well, let's expand it to other schools in the city of Los Angeles, particularly to schools in less well-off districts. We've actually managed to put in, I think today, this is the 32nd school that we've done. So we've been really busy. We have so many great people here. We have a bunch of parents from the school. We have principals out here today. We have teachers. We have lots of kids from the local middle school. We have fish over here. We have students from UCLA. We have and the Enrich LA regulars. Here you go. Four, two more coming up. Well, think about it. The kids are stuck in a classroom all day long, and that's good, of course. This is a way for them to come out, you know, maybe 2 hours every week, have a little bit of fun, do some gardening, and actually play house, which I think they gather around the new outdoor kitchen that we're building. They gather around and they're preparing food. Who wouldn't like that? The end goal is a garden in every school in the city of Los Angeles. There are about 600 public schools, and so we have 30 something done, and we have a ways to go, but we're moving pretty fast. Of all the schools in the United States, people should open up their own nonprofits in the cities across the United States and get these edible gardens in. Our schools are not very pretty. If you look at university campuses in this country, they're stunning. Look at UCLA. And our schools, frankly, sometimes look like prisons. So my advice is open up your nonprofit, get to work, gather a bunch of volunteers. There are lots of people in every city who want to work, who want to do good if you give them the opportunity to do so.
All right. Wow. That gave in just a few minutes a whole spectrum of questions.
Yes, indeed.
For me. I guess what I'd like to start out first is it mentioned in the video clip that you started at a garden at your daughter's school.
Yes.
So tell me why you found, how did you identify that as a need?
Very simply, Justine and I are a parent of four kids, and we have a choice. We can work very hard and send all our kids to private school, mm-hmm. or we can participate in the public school system and get involved, and particularly in the Los Feliz Silver Lake area, it's a long tradition of parent involvement. Mm-hmm. And that's why, frankly, we have really good schools. Yeah. And we looked at King Middle School, and we wanted our daughter to attend there, all of our kids, actually, to attend there. It's a local school, it's within walking distance. Uh-huh. And so I met with the principal, and I said, what are your needs? And she said, the place could look better. And I said, let me see what we can do about a vegetable garden. Started the vegetable garden, what did that do? It encouraged so many people to come and help, because once you build a garden, it's an opportunity for people to volunteer, not just parents, but outsiders, because everybody believes they can garden better than the next person. Everybody believes, oh, no, you're doing it wrong. Let me show
yes,
you how.
Right.
So we built the garden, and that was the beginning of the renaissance of the school. And I'm so pleased to say that last year, King Middle School is one of the most improved middle schools in all of the state of California, clocked in at the high eights with our API, went all the way from six something when we started. So a vegetable garden, it's a beautiful thing. It cheers up the students mm-hmm. and cheers up the teachers.
Right.
They need a little cheering up. Who doesn't like seeing a tomato on
right.
the vine?
Right.
Who doesn't like seeing a field of mustard greens, which, by the way, we have growing at El Sereno Middle School right now. So, yeah, that's what it's about. And doing that we saw the Renaissance effect it had, mm-hmm. and then my friend Leonardo and I said, let's take this citywide. Let's see what we can do to help others.
Okay. All right, so basically it's just going out and asking, what are the needs?
Yes.
You probably had already had some drive-bys around the neighborhood and you saw, you know, the conditions, and our schools have so much blacktop.
Yes, they
and
do.
So little green. And if your experiences is like mine, my growing up, my school had lots of trees and
of
lots
course.
Of grass. So
yeah.
So we are in a very different situation here. And so just assessing some needs is typically how we all start out. Identifying an issue and then just getting in there and, you know, going yeah. little by little. Now, what prompted you to pick a vegetable garden as opposed to a flower garden?
Okay, so edible garden, because they have multiple effects.
Uh-huh.
They have a beautifying effect, obviously. They have an inquiry effect in that everybody loves to see food being grown. Mm-hmm. And to be honest, it's where we're from. We, after being hunters, we became mm-hmm. gatherers, and then we became farmers. Mm-hmm. There's a little bit of the farmer in every one of us, and I grew up on a farm, obviously. People like to see, oh my goodness, there's tomatoes over there, let me go steal one.
Uh-huh.
There's some basil over there, let me make myself a caprese salad.
Uh-huh.
Then the other part of it is obviously the nutrition crisis that we have, particularly in this city and particularly in the most urban parts of it. Mm-hmm. We have a particular emphasis along the 110 corridor. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of schools right on the freeway with little or no green space, and they're in food deserts. And sometimes the only access they have are in small stores that don't have a large fresh food section. We're trying to expose these young folks to the finer foods of life right. that wealthy folks have access to.
Right,
yes.
Right, and I think typically that term food desert may be something that's new to many of you. We talk about neighborhoods where we have lots of fast food, we have lots of mom and pop
yes.
stores, but we don't have a grocery store with produce that's fresh and easy to eat. The mom and pop stores might have a few things, but they don't invest a lot of money into the produce because they don't sell a lot. Therefore, they lose their investment. So these food deserts, and Los Angeles is famous for having multiple neighborhoods
Indeed.
Like that.
Indeed.
But the garden provides that little opportunity to link nutrition education in a
yes.
classroom with the school meal program where kids are eating some of the produce, and now they're actually seeing where it's grown. So
yes.
I think it does have a benefit to students' health. And I know one of our students had asked a question earlier. Good morning, Janie. Just asking, can healthier foods improve or boost our immune system? Well, we certainly know that fruits and vegetables have all of those vitamins and minerals that do play a factor in all of that. And of course, if kids are growing them and seeing them.
Of course.
Of course
yeah.
they're going to eat them, right?
And they're going to want to eat right. them. It's not, we all understand the evidence
right.
that we ought to be eating. You have your plate here, that we ought to be eating more fruits and vegetables. The issue is how do we get kids to want to eat
right.
them? And so our emphasis, again, is making these gardens colorful mm-hmm. and keeping them look beautiful. This is, we're all attracted to beautiful things. And sort of getting the kids to play house, to
uh-huh.
play farmer.
Uh-huh.
We have little outdoor kitchens in some of these gardens, and we have nutrition classes, and they go off to, you know, our garden rangers, we call them, they're there, and they're preparing some food, and we have the kids go and pick. You know, and a good example is bruschetta,
uh-huh.
Chopping up the tomatoes, adding some olive oil. We have a little outdoor sink, the kids get to wash them, mm-hmm. go pick the basil, chop it all up, put it on a little toasted baguette. We have
uh-huh.
a little deal with Whole Foods. They supply
okay.
us with free baguettes.
Okay.
And the kids go wild for them. They're just amazed at how tasty, yet so healthy
right.
something
right.
can be. And so we're making them, and again, into food snobs. A thing I like to remind the young men in particular in middle school is, you know, women are drawn to men who can cook. Women are drawn to men who understand food and understand the romance of food. There's nothing more romantic than creating a healthy meal out of a couple of simple ingredients,
uh-huh.
and it can be very inexpensive. It can be a way to have a cheat date,
right.
but yet right. yet making an effort.
So we're getting kids to eat foods that, had they been offered that at a restaurant, they might go, oh no, I'm not eating basil. Basil is leaves. You know, tomatoes, that they're nasty. So you've got that, but what you've brought out is another element that we look at in health education, and that's the social health component. While you're focusing on them eating healthy foods for their bodies, you know, and the beautification being an impact on their mental, emotional health, this whole social climate is changing at these schools, isn't it?
Of course. I mean, the school system did get it wrong. They built, as you mentioned earlier, this vernacular of wall-to-wall asphalt and mm-hmm. chain-link fence. Mm-hmm. Well, that's prison vernacular. That mm-hmm. should not be educational institution design elements. And so, yes, by changing this atmosphere, by creating something that's beautiful, we'll look at the universities. Mm-hmm. They understand it. Right. Look at UCLA in Mid-City. They get it. Rolling hills, large trees. By changing this atmosphere and by showing the children and the teachers, mm-hmm. or maybe not so much the teachers, showing the children that sitting around a table, an outdoor picnic area, mm-hmm. al fresco dining, for goodness sake, sitting around and having a meal and maybe some table manners. What's wrong with table manners? Right. What's wrong with saying grace? It doesn't have to be religious. Right. It means taking a moment, taking the time to have a formal meal and enjoy each other's company.
Right. And then I think the other thing that I saw in your video clip is all of the, it's not just about the kids and the teachers and the principal at the school site, but now you've got parents coming in, you've got neighbors coming in, you've got volunteers from all over.
Yeah.
How does that happen? It's like a contagious virus.
Well, let me say that it needs to happen. One of the things that the school system, and I want to start by paying a great compliment to Los Angeles Unified because they have welcomed this.
Yeah.
They've gotten a lot of bad press in the last couple of years for all kinds of things, but they've been very cooperative. They have welcomed this and they've encouraged it. So one of the things that the system has done wrong in the past, they put up these fences, mm-hmm. large gates, people at the door. You know, why are you trying to come in? We need to open these schools to the community. Schools were meant to be community centers, mm-hmm. a place for people to come and gather, to come and learn, to come and enjoy each other. Mm-hmm. And by creating these gardens and making it easy for people to come to volunteer, because this city has a real tradition of volunteering, mm-hmm. and we've seen it. We've made it easy for people to volunteer. We have hundreds of people coming out on Saturdays in particular to build, particularly young university students, mm-hmm. want to do something, want to make a difference in somebody else's life, and frankly, want to socialize with others. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. it's working. And people love to work hard. They miss it.
Right.
Yes.
Well, I think, you know, what you are doing exemplifies a lot of what we've been talking about in class. You know, assessing needs and then really knowing your audience.
Yes.
My guess is that you probably have a different speech or a different approach to your message depending on whether you're talking to a district level administrator, a site principal, a parent, a student,
yes.
or one of your university volunteers. Am I correct?
Well, you're absolutely right. So we take it from the top. When we are dealing, for example, with the Facilities Division of Los Angeles Unified, what they want to hear is that we have it together, uh-huh. that we're going to do something in a safe fashion, that we have proper insurance, that we have taken care of all of the permits, and that we will respect their protocols and rules. Okay. And we've done that. We're not rebels. We're not hippies. We're trying to build these assets uh-huh. and build them to be safe assets for outdoor classrooms for folks to use. When we're talking to principals, we are saying to them, this is not a diversion from your learning. This, in fact, is your learning. This is simply another classroom. And now, by adopting Common Core, and our new curriculum is tied right in with Common Core, no longer do teachers have to make an excuse to come out for an hour.
Right.
This is part of their learning, and something they can learn something in the garden in 10 seconds that'll take them hours inside of the classroom because it's experiential. It's right there before them.
It's that real world approach to learning.
Indeed. And then finally with volunteers, we're speaking to them in a more romantic fashion and reminding them, frankly, you are here because you are possibly guilt-ridden because of your good fortune. And uh-huh. so you should be. Uh-huh. You have good fortune to be in university. Uh-huh. You have good fortune to live in a nice neighborhood. And you have a couple of hours to give up to volunteer. And we're telling them, we're building these assets. We're laying sprinklers. And we need to work really hard because we only have 8 hours. And you're actually not going to get to plant. You know why you're not going to get to plant? Because we're trying to build these assets so the kids can get to plant. Right. And they embrace it. They love it. They love this idea of giving back. And oh boy, some of them are very surprised at the amount of hard work. And you saw it in the video, right. Me barking at them.
Yeah.
Let's get this done because right. We want these kids. We want that wow effect. We want them to feel
right.
Also that people. Other people care about them.
Right.
You know, that yeah. Somebody came, a fairy godmother came during the weekend and built an asset that's easy to use. Yeah. So it's got automatic sprinklers, it's got the beds, and it's got the new soil, and it's ready for them to use.
Right, right.
So,
you're just doing so much of what our theoretical foundations tell us to
yes.
do.
Yes,
and it works. So you did all of this at your child's school.
Yes.
And now you're up to how many school
well,
sites?
Well, 54 schools, and were it not raining today, I would be there today and would be on number 55.
Okay, so we're yes. thankful for the rain because you're here today.
Well,
how did that happen? How does it happen that you as a parent in a school site are now looking at this very large project over 50-some school sites?
Well, it happens because there are more like you, and this is a message that I know that you give to your students. There are collaborators out there. Mm-hmm. You just need to find them. Mm-hmm. There are folks in every part of this city. There are companies. There are universities. There are community groups. There are folks who care, who want to deliver this product, and this product is edible school gardens. We simply connected with them. We connected with UCLA. We connected with Fox Gives. We connected with Kaiser. We connected with all Boston Consulting. I can go on
and on. Yeah.
And they delivered money. Mm-hmm. They delivered volunteers. Ticketmaster had 100 employees hauling out asphalt mm-hmm. on the hottest day of the year 2 years ago at Alta Loma Elementary.
Glad to
do it because they want to do yes. something, and they want to do something tangible,
right.
not the photo op. They want to see right. something that they're doing that's real. And we simply put all the pieces together. And you know, one of the programs that we do is with companies. We say your career building and team building day should not be out sailing, should not be sitting around in a nice hotel. You should be in the middle of the city doing something, giving back, and that's how you'll see then how your team members behave.
Right.
And so that's a great program for us, and they bring money to the table to help us pay for the program. And it means building gardens every other Saturday. So we are exhausted,
I guess, but it's
certainly keeping me fit, and a lot of people fit, and there's a bit of an urgency about it too. Mm-hmm. And there's an urgency where you have teachers who normally just work from 9 to 5, Monday to Friday. They're coming back out. We have a teacher over at King Middle School who comes all over the city with us because he said, this is what I want the school system to be about. I don't want to just go home on a Friday evening. I want to help do carpentry on the weekends. Let me just finally say, it's bringing strangers inside the fence. And those strangers are troublemakers. When I say troublemakers, in a good way.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Each and every stranger who comes in is bringing some new idea in. He's rubbing shoulders with the teacher, and he's saying to the teacher, why don't we do it this way? Uh-huh. Why don't we try this? And that's what we're trying to do, bring artists inside the school system, bring gardeners in, mm-hmm. bring musicians. Now, can you imagine, fast forward, these gardens act as a Trojan horse for all of these different actors in the city uh-huh. in there having sort of their own little studio and uh-huh. the students uh-huh. getting to see how other people live. And that's what we're trying to do. Get them to feel that they can do anything they want right. to do by talking to the potter, by talking to the gardener, by talking to the right. chef.
Right.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, again, for those of us who've looked at theoretical foundations, it's like we are not a little island unto ourselves. You know, we talk about, you know, we need to make an impact. And we certainly, I mean, that's the first step, is you just
yes.
have to step out and do it. But
absolutely.
Like you said, then you find a couple others who are of the same thought and the same commitment of degrees. You probably have more commitment than some, but really all getting out there for a common goal. And I love the fact that not only are we talking about healthy foods and in a much broader context, but you also brought out the physical activity piece. I think so many of our kids and our families and our community in general think of physical activity as, oh my gosh, I have to exercise.
Yes.
Oh, I have to do this. And it's not enjoyable. And you're providing a model and an opportunity for what you call hard work, but it's really physical activity at its finest.
And it's physical activity that is not selfish. And what I mean by that is, yes, when you go to the gym, you are doing physical activity, but it's really just for yourself. And it's very sad because you've your headphones on there, you're doing your own thing. How about doing physical activity helping others? It's a win-win. You're getting you're getting lots of exercise, and people are going home with aches and pains. It's nice for them to get healthier doing so. It's also nice for them to appreciate those of those in society who do this on a daily basis out in the fields. And, you know, it honors them. It really reminds us where our food comes from and what people have to do to make that happen.
Absolutely. Yeah. What a connect. Yeah. All right. So we've talked a lot about the your school program, which you call Ranger Program.
Yes. Garden Rangers.
Garden
just like a
Rangers.
Park ranger.
Okay.
Yes.
But your organization has gone beyond the garden. And you also now have something called Public Works.
Yes.
Let's see, you've got the Building Program, which are green spaces around schools, the Garden Ranger Program, and then Public Works.
So,
now, how does that fit in with what I've learned about a new project called Land Bridge?
Yes. So we are, so we've all these schools, you know, these are community centers in the neighborhoods. But the kids go home every day at 3 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and we're asking them to be active. We're asking them to cycle and walk. We're asking them to engage in the community. But sadly, this city is freeways and streets and speeding cars and a difficulty to get out there and walk and enjoy the public spaces. And so we are seeing a worrisome trend as, you know, in the last few years, as we rebuild our infrastructure. They're building them in the old ways. They're building bridges to get cars across the rivers, in particular, rapidly to get them from A to B. No. We want people to slow down. We see Europe doing this. We see a lot of cities, London, Dublin, and Paris in particular, the ones I'm familiar with, where they've turned their bridges into centers where people linger. So, you know, one example is Hyperion Bridge in Los Feliz. They had a new plan to rebuild the bridge. But you know what? The plan was to get the cars across the bridge quicker. That doesn't make any sense. We are renovating our river. We have wonderful organizations, Fuller, who have been advocating to restore the river in the last 20 years. Now we want people to start hanging out and appreciating it.
Mm-hmm.
So we put a plan. We've worked with architects to encourage the city to create a boardwalk, to create larger sidewalks so people would linger, and to slow down the traffic. Maybe they'll slow down so much that they'll roll down their window, maybe say hello, for goodness sake.
Wouldn't that be a different world, a different Los Angeles?
And the other one then that we're working on is, well, they're building a new bridge to replace monument number 908, which is the old Figueroa Riverside Bridge, right there on the corner where the 5 and the 110 meet. They're building the new one, and their plan is to demolish the old one. It's just south of it. We put forward a plan to the city of Los Angeles. Wait a minute, why not turn the old one into a park? Give the opportunity for people to hang out on the river and to enjoy the surroundings of the river and the surroundings of our transportation system. I always think if we could hang out there, I could take my son Dylan and we could sit there and watch the trains go by. It's so romantic.
Yeah.
And slow down a little. And so we're advocating that. We've been gathering community support for it. And actually tomorrow we're doing a pop-up land bridge right on at 12:30 where we're bringing trees and chairs and we're bringing produce from our school gardens. We're giving out free food, free wonderful whole food. We're going to hang out there for an hour. People are going to sit and they're going to see what it's like to hang out on this bridge. And all we're saying to the city of Los Angeles is change your change your outlook. Let's save some of these historical structures, mm-hmm. which I think we've a bit of a bad reputation mm-hmm. in the Southland. We haven't saved some of them. We regretted that. Mm-hmm. And save it and have a park there and save a few dollars to boot. We built that thing. Why knock it down?
Right.
So.
Right.
Yeah.
Wow. So much.
And busy.
It had just started from building a garden
it
at
had.
Your child's school.
But it's everybody else who was helping. That's
absolutely.
The thing. There are people in this city that really do care, just like yourself. They really care about the bigger community. They're not just making money for themselves. Right. They want to give something back. We've worked with some wonderful architects who are doing this.
And it really does take individuals stepping up, though, to say,
yes, it does.
You know, I'm committed to this. I want my community to be better, to be healthier.
Yeah.
And so I guess, you know, that's my word of encouragement to students who are watching this morning is,
of course.
You know, whatever small encouragement you give to a friend, to a family member, to improve their health, you know, it can snowball. And then all of a sudden there's another family member who's talking with them, or you're talking with your friends.
Yes,
and all
indeed.
Of a sudden in
yes,
this
indeed.
Conversation of friends, somebody else goes, oh yeah. And so, but it does take somebody stepping out and saying the first word or digging the first piece of asphalt out of a playground. I do want to just share with all of you the website. It's fascinating, and I do hope you will go on it. Enrich LA, thank you. That's up on the screen now. One, it's visually beautiful.
Thank you.
There is information about the Land Bridge event tomorrow. There you can click on a variety of tabs down here. If you want more information about the Garden Ranger program, obviously go there, see what you find. Lots of ways to get involved. Here's the public works piece that I shared a little bit about. Lots of video clips, lots of gorgeous pictures that are being grown on school gardens, being consumed by our kids,
yeah.
taking advantage of what's already there.
And there's one that we just added this morning, which is very pertinent. It's a dry creek that we built at our El Serena Middle School. You know we're going through
okay.
a drought.
Yes.
And we built a dry creek which captures rainwater instead of sending it to the Santa Monica Bay. And the kids loved it. They were all there watching this little mini river.
Okay.
Yeah.
And after the couple of days we've had,
yes.
it
yeah.
might be more than a little mini river.
Of course.
But I anticipate there's a lot more growth going to be out there in
Indeed.
The next
yes.
little bit.
Yeah.
Wow. Well, thank you so
oh
much
goodness.
For
thank
being
you.
With
thank
us.
You.
Any last words or words of encouragement to college students who are learning about making their healthy, making their communities healthy
yeah.
and what they could do?
Well, I think they should take Madam's advice, get out there, make some mistakes, mm-hmm. you know, go try to build a garden at your local area, community, school, what have you. Try to do something, make those mistakes, learn from them, mm-hmm. and build something bigger and greater. There are just so many people out there who are looking to partner. It's,
right.
it's a great city.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you so much. and I think this is one way of really linking all of that we've talked about in class, just with your physical health, your mental, emotional health, your social health, looking at how some of these kinds of activities really have a benefit not only on the individual and the family, but on the community as a whole. And certainly when we think about Los Angeles, it's hundreds of communities
Indeed.
In a community.
Yes.
So you don't have to go out and attack the entire South Bay
yeah.
area, but start where you are and go from there. I think this is a great way to kind of conclude a couple of broadcasts on nutrition and physical activity and really looking at it from a very positive perspective. You know, when we're thinking about this as a health concern in our communities and what we can do, I would just encourage you to focus on healthy eating instead of weight. I think if we're focusing on what's growing
Excellent.
In the garden
yes.
rather than eat this so you'll lose weight, we're a little bit more apt to do that.
Yes.
And of course, including that physical activity in there as well. Looking carefully at how we talk about food issues. And I love how you talk a little high. It's like, let's go for the romantic dinners. We don't usually think about that when we're talking with particularly kids in schools. But what a great thing. It's just like, let's focus on the positive. Let's talk about how this is making our community better. Just in fact, it's beautiful. It's elegant.
Food is beautiful.
And
can be beautiful.
Absolutely. Yes. And you know, I think that tends to go to that positivity end. We need to really watch our conversations around dieting. I think oftentimes we're so focused on what we want to do to lose weight, we lose the focus on what we should be eating to enjoy life.
Yes.
And it is balance and moderation. But if we've got fresh fruits and vegetables and good grains, we can eat lots of those.
Indeed.
Focusing on enjoyable physical activity rather than exercise. You know, when somebody tells me I need to exercise, I just kind of cringe, probably not just inside, but literally cringe away.
Yes.
But talk about going and doing something fun, enjoyable.
Yes.
You're still doing physical activity. And then supporting individual and community change. So if, I think if we kind of think about all that we do in that perspective, that's a good perspective to go from. But certainly when you're sitting there and you're thinking, oh my gosh, I have to do this project for class in doing something around teaching someone how to be a little healthier, don't get stuck in the structure. Think about how you could do it in a creative way. Certainly, I don't know that you started out thinking you were going to improve the nutritional status and academic performance of your students.
No.
You just wanted to make it pretty.
Absolutely.
But in doing the make it pretty, we took it to the next level. So that's what I encourage all of you to do. This pretty much concludes our broadcast today. Thank you all for being with us. And I do hope you will go to the enrichla.org website. Take a look. Gather a little bit of inspiration from that. Next week, we're going to start looking around another issue that affects the health of our communities, and that's alcohol, tobacco, and other drugs. We'll spend a couple of weeks on those issues and what we might be able to do to address that in a way to facilitate that healthier community. So here is wishing you all health and peace and happiness this week. Go find a garden to volunteer at. Anyway, enjoy your week, and I'll see you back here next Saturday. Thanks for joining us.